Hey everyone, welcome back or welcome to my channel if you're new here. So today's video is really important because it's another missing persons case, and it's a case that I've noticed hasn't gotten a lot of attention, and it's really important that we spread the word because it's been over a month since this person has last been found. So we really need to get the word out if we want him to be found soon and his family to be given closure. With all of that being said, let's just get into my usual disclaimer. So I'm reporting on very public information that anyone has access to. All of the opinions stated are my own, unless I say otherwise, and all of my sources will be linked down below. Now let's get into it. Jason Landry is 21 years old and a student at Texas State University in San Marcos, Texas. Unfortunately, I couldn't find much about his interests or what he was studying in school, but I was able to find through his Facebook that he currently works at Jimmy John's, and his dad has said that he loved to play video games with his friends. On December 13th at around 11 p.m., so late into the night, Jason was heading home from Texas State University back to Missouri City, Texas to spend the Christmas holiday with his family. He had just recently finished finals, so he was ready to get back home and spend time with family and friends. What happens after this point is a complete mystery, but what we do know is that early in the morning on December 14th at around 12:30 a.m., a volunteer firefighter called in Jason's car and said that he saw it off of Flat State Road near Loling, Texas in a ditch. This was really strange because it was only 30 minutes from Texas State University, so Jason hadn't made it very far. Also, this area was not on Jason's route home, so it was bizarre that his car would be found so off of his usual route. So authorities responded pretty quickly to this call, and when they arrived at the scene, they noticed that the car appeared to be in just a single car accident, so that the car had either hit a tree or skidded off the road, and that not another car had been involved. What they found to be really strange, though, was that Jason's phone and his keys were still in the car, and he was nowhere to be found. Additionally, they found his backpack outside the car and a small amount of blood inside the car, which they found to be very concerning because that could indicate that he had been hurt. They sent this blood to be tested at the lab, but as we know from other cases, it often takes a while for DNA testing, so police have yet to release if they know if this was Jason's blood or if it still hasn't been tested yet. Police initially said that they believed that Jason's car spun out of control and hit a tree, which is why there was such extensive damage to the back of the car and not the front. There was also some of his clothes scattered around the car. Now going back to Jason's backpack that was found outside the car. So the backpack was found 110 feet south of the car, and when they looked inside, police said that they found narcotics. Now, this has been a big point of contention online and caused a lot of speculation. Police haven't released what these narcotics were. However, it's a big possibility that it was just prescription drugs that Jason was taking and it was nothing illegal. However, you know how the internet is, and a lot of people speculate that these were illegal drugs and that he was somehow involved in drug trafficking or doing drugs. However, Jason's dad has spoken out and said that this is completely not true, so we really don't have anything to go off of. And at this point, I bet that it could be prescription drugs, but again, we don't know, and I don't think it's fair to speculate at this point. So now back to the timeline. At 2 a.m. on December 14th, Jason's parents awoke to a phone call from the highway patrol officer saying that Jason's car had been in an accident. They also said that they couldn't find Jason anywhere near the accident and that his cell phone was still there. So police quickly returned the cell phone to Jason's parents, which I think was a big mistake because this is a big piece of evidence and police really should have looked into this first. But either way, they did return the cell phone to Jason's parents, and shortly after this, he was listed as a missing person, and the search began for him. So the police and Texas Equisearch got involved right away and started the search for Jason because they knew that time was of the essence, and if he was in the wilderness somewhere, it was key that they found him right away. So they started a search, and this search involved dogs, sniffer dogs, and the dogs actually traced his scent to an abandoned building nearby as well as a pond, and they actually ended up draining the pond and searching through the building, but there was no trace of Jason in either of these places. On the 22nd of December, Texas Equisearch announced that they were suspending their search until police could give them more information about where Jason could be. They said that they felt like they'd used all their resources and that nothing could be done at this point until more tips were called in. At this point, since the physical search has been stopped, police have said that they're trying to look into Jason's digital footprint. However, they say that he has a really complex security code on his phone and that it might take months to crack. However, they are still looking into his social media accounts and his Google accounts in the meantime to see if there was anyone he was communicating with on the days leading up to his disappearance. Now, the most recent update we have in this case is from Friday, January 8th, when police released a new photo from the same weekend Jason went missing and are going to use this on his missing poster to replace the old photo. Now, Jason does look a lot more disheveled in this new photo. However, I don't think this is a big deal because he is a college student and so he was probably stressed out and had just finished finals. Now, when I first heard about this case, it really reminded me of the disappearance of Bryce Laspecia, who went missing on August 30th, 2013. He was also a college student, like Jason, and disappeared on his way back home from Sierra College to his house in Laguna Niguel, California. At 2 a.m., Bryce called his mom and told her that he was too tired to finish the drive home and that he would sleep in his car that night and finish the drive when he woke up. However, a few hours later, his car was found on its side with its window smashed with all of his belongings still inside, which sounds very similar to Jason. Just like in Jason's case, Bryce's car was abandoned and he has never been heard from since and is still a missing person to this day. Now, I found it interesting that on Bryce's Facebook page, like the Facebook page to help find Bryce, the family actually shared something about Jason being missing, so I definitely think that they see the similarities between these two cases as well. While I don't think that the same person, if there was a person involved, harmed Bryce and Jason because Bryce was in California and Jason was in Texas, I do think it's important to bring up these cases and their similarities because they were both college students and they were both facing the same kinds of stresses in their lives, and their cars were found very similarly in the same kind of way, and no trace of either of them has been found. So I do find these similarities very interesting, and I just had to mention that. So because there's so little information in Jason's case, and I've mentioned everything that's out there in the media and the news that I could find, it has caused a lot of speculation, and there are many theories about what could have happened to him. So the most popular theory, and the one that I'm kind of leaning towards, is the possibility that Jason was using some kind of GPS app on his phone to get back home, and this GPS took him off his usual route to Salt Flat Road, and he kind of went off his usual route and got confused, and maybe because it was dark or because an animal ran out in front of him, he lost control of his car and he ended up hitting a tree. And this caused him to suffer some kind of injury, possibly a brain injury. And so he got out of the car, and if he had a brain injury, he would have just been very confused and not knowing where he was. And this could have caused him to wander off and either, you know, meet harm, or he could have possibly ended up in the woods and gotten lost. There's also a possibility that this head injury caused him to have amnesia and that he possibly has no idea who he is and that he's still out there somewhere wandering around and confused. This theory seems likely because Jason was driving late at night and he could have been tired and either not seen an animal or, you know, just drifted off to sleep, and this could have caused him to get into his accident. And there's also a lot of animals known to be on this road at night, so it wouldn't be unlikely that he could have hit one of them and that could have caused his car wreck. However, what contradicts this theory is that the police have said that they believe that the operator of the vehicle escaped with little to no injuries, and a head injury is a big one, so this kind of goes against what the police are saying. There was also only a teeny amount of blood found in his car, and if he had hit his head in this crash, I believe that there would have been a lot more blood or evidence of an injury. What also makes people question this theory is that EquiSearch did a very thorough search of the area around the crash site, and they found nothing leading them to believe that Jason was out in the woods somewhere. If he was confused and had wandered out there, EquiSearch would have found either his body or him alive trying to find his way out, or his footprints, and they found none of that. So that's kind of what leads people to believe that this isn't what happened. Another theory in this case is that Jason wasn't the one driving the car at all, and it was someone else, and that either harm got to him before he even started his drive or somewhere along the way. Now, there is no evidence leading anyone to believe this, except for the fact that police said that they believe the operator of the vehicle is unharmed, and they didn't say Jason is unharmed. So that leads people to think that maybe the operator of the vehicle isn't Jason, and that police have more information than they're giving out. Now, the only evidence that would conclusively say that this is true is if there was CCTV footage along the way or like traffic light cameras that showed someone else driving Jason's car that wasn't him. Also, because police haven't been able to get into Jason's phone yet, they don't know if he was planning on meeting up with someone, because that would definitely give them some kind of idea that someone else could have been in the car with him. However, none of this has been released, and so we have no clue if this was the case or not. Now, a third theory that I've also seen floating around is that Jason was possibly the victim of a carjacking. Now, there's no evidence for this. Like I said, there's no CCTV footage to indicate that Jason stopped anywhere along his route. However, Lulling is a high crime area, and crimes like this are known to happen in the area, so I think that's kind of where people get this idea from. However, I find it personally very unlikely that this happened, because Jason had to have been in the wrong place at the wrong time, and Salt Flat Road is really isolated, so I doubt that someone was just sitting there hoping that someone would come on that road to carjack them, because again, it seems like very few people go on this road, so it really had to have been a very bad opportunity for this to have happened. I'm really not sure what to think in this case, because like I said, there's a lot of evidence that contradicts all of these theories, and the fact that Jason hasn't been spotted since, or no one has come forward saying they've seen him, is really scary to me, because if he were out there with amnesia somewhere, you would think that someone would have seen him or reported him, because this case does seem to be big in the Texas area. And so I would hope someone would come forward, but no one has. It seems like he just vanished into thin air. There is a big possibility that the searchers missed something along the way. You know, they are still human, even though they are specially trained, and there have been cases where searchers have missed crucial evidence in cases. And so I think that maybe this was the case, and there could be evidence still out there in either the pond or the wooded area near the car wreck that shows where Jason could have been. I really think that Jason's phone is going to be crucial in solving this case, and I think police need to figure out who he was talking to the day he went missing in order to really crack this case wide open and see if possibly he was planning on meeting up with someone that night. I know that GPSs usually let you know when you go off course, and yeah, you know, sometimes if you're tired, maybe you don't hear it, or possibly he was planning on turning around later, but Salt Flat Road is really far off from where he was going, which leads me to believe that maybe he was purposely there and he was planning on meeting up with someone. But again, that's just speculation, and there's no evidence for this. I also find it hard to believe that Jason could have gotten so far from the crash site in such a short period of time on foot, especially if he suffered some sort of injury in the wreck. Now, when police arrived at his car, they found no sign of him anywhere in the area. He was nowhere around there. They looked around for him and couldn't find him. And if he were on foot, I find it hard to believe that he could have fled so quickly, especially, like I said, if he was injured. And I think that leads me to believe that maybe another car came and picked him up. Although I have no evidence of this, I'm just speculating based on the information that I have. I really don't know what to think in this case. It really confuses me, and I have no main theory that I believe, which is really unlikely for me because usually in these cases, I tend to lean one way or another, but in this case, I don't know what to believe because all the evidence seems to contradict itself, and we really don't have much to go off of at this point. Because such a thorough search has been done and Jason hasn't been found, it leads me to believe that he was carried in a vehicle to some other location, and that possibly he could be somewhere with either amnesia, or he could be harmed possibly from, you know, the crash, or from someone who wanted to do him harm, unfortunately. But yeah, I don't know what to think in this case, and I really hope that Jason's family get answers soon, and I really hope that Jason's safe somewhere, and that he possibly hit his head and he'll come to soon and realize that, you know, his family's looking for him. But that's all I have for you today, guys. Thank you so much for listening to Jason's story, and please help spread the word so that Jason can be found safe and brought home to his family. Thanks again, guys, for watching this video, and be sure to like and subscribe for more true crime content. See you guys soon. Bye.